BBC Sounds. Music, radio, podcasts.
Hello, I'm Lauren Laverne, and this is the Desert Island Discs podcast. Every week, I ask my guests to choose the 8 tracks, book, and luxury they'd want to take with them if they were cast away to a desert island. And, for rights reasons, the music is shorter than the original broadcast. I hope you enjoy listening. My castaway this week is the actor and director Richard Wilson. His career on stage, screen and in the director's chair stretches back over 50 years, but his star rose to new heights when, in his mid-50s, he took on the role of perpetually apoplectic pensioner Victor Meldrew in One Foot in the Grave. In the course of just 36 episodes, the series changed his life and spawned an unlikely folk hero. It's still frequently voted one of the best sitcoms of all time. I was, he says, always a late developer. Born in Greenock, he nursed the dream to act from an early age, moving to London to be closer to the worlds of film and theatre. A chance encounter led him to jack in his steady job as a hospital lab technician and take up a place at RADA as a mature student. As an actor, he strives to keep a distance between himself and his characters for the sake of his craft. His focus rests on getting an audience to coin a phrase, believe it. He says, if the performance is going to astonish, if a human being is able to be truly metamorphic, then the less we know about the toenail clippings and belching of the person behind the mask, the better. Well, I do like a challenge. Richard Wilson, welcome to Desert Island Discs.
Thank you, Lauren.
So, Richard, your theatre career has encompassed many of the classics, but as a director, you do favour new work by up-and-coming writers. Why is that?
Yes, well, I just believe that the writer should be writing about today, just so that we know what's going on in the society we're living in. So I'm slightly against the classical playwrights, in a way.
And the fact that, you know, these are living writers, presumably that gives you a chance to ask them what they meant and take in their perspective.
Yes, exactly.
Do you enjoy those discussions?
Oh, yes. They can tell me what I'm getting wrong. And I just think it's good that they get every opportunity to tell us what it is they're thinking about.
Richard, you're in your 80s now.
85 in July.
Well, happy birthday for July.
Thank you.
Do you enjoy passing on the benefit of your experience and your love of the arts to friends?
Yes. I still think I have something to say. And so I think, probably wrongly, I think of what I have to say. I have had 50 years to think about it, and I'm pretty sure that I'm correct of most of what I say.
Well, we're hoping to find out today. We're also, of course, going to hear the discs that you've chosen. Let's get straight into your first. Tell me the story behind this one. Why are you taking it with you?
Well, there was a time when I was a teenager and not an actor that I wanted to be an orchestral conductor. And I used to do a lot of conducting with my mother's knitting needle. And I was very fond of Sibelius's Sixth Symphony, and I thought it would be a good idea to buy a proper baton for it. So I went up to Glasgow and went into this shop, and I was absolutely petrified, because if I asked for a conductor's baton, she might say, so which orchestra are you conducting? So I said, excuse me, could I have a baton, please? And she said, what do you want, 10 and 6 or 15 shillings?
Thank you. part of the fourth movement of Sibelius' Symphony No. 6 in D minor, performed by the Berlin Philharmonic, conducted by Herbert von Karajan. Richard Wilson, you had a heart attack in 2016, and of course life changed after that for you, didn't it?
Yeah. I fell off this tiny balcony and hit my head, and that's what caused the problem. I can't remember quite so much now. And sometimes I do remember bits which I had forgotten about.
And has it changed your attitude? I mean, you're still working, but I'm presuming you're pretty choosy about the projects you decide to take on.
Yes, I choose more carefully now. And doing theatre work, for example, is, you know, 8 shows a week is too much for me now.
So, Richard, let's go back a bit then. You were born Ian Wilson in 1936 in Greenock, a port and shipbuilding hub on Scotland's west coast. And I know that your father, John, worked at Scott's, which was the biggest of the shipyards, and he was head timekeeper. What did his job involve?
I remember him. He was quite a small man, my father, about 5'6". And I could remember being in the shipyard with him at knocking off time, which was 5 o'clock, and he used to get the big gates of the shipyard open and stand in front of the open gates so that the men couldn't rush out.
And what was your dad like? Did you have a close relationship?
I did have a close relationship. My mother was the funny person in the family. She was very amusing. My dad was more serious. She was allowed not to go to church by my father.
So he's a Presbyterian, quite strict.
Presbyterian, one of the church orderlies. And he wanted me and my sister to go to church with him. But my mother was always excused church, and I never really found out why. And I suspect it was because she wasn't religious. But she was just very amusing and always telling her own little stories and being very humorous about day-to-day living.
The games that you played with your sister Moira in the garden shed sound a bit like, you know, they indicate that you had a flair for the dramatic, even as a kid. I think one early role that you played was of the last baby in the world.
That's right.
Which just sounds like a cracker, a role.
Yes, I was the last baby in the world, and she chose me because there was nothing else there. And I think I remember playing her dog as well. My sister died recently at 91. She did very well. But she was very good with her instructions, like playing her dog in The Last Baby in the World. Yeah.
She's a natural casting director, perhaps.
maybe.
All right, Richard, it's time for your second piece of music today. What have you chosen and why?
I've chosen Farewell to Stromness by Peter Maxwell Davis because I wanted to make sure I got some Scottish stuff in, because I've lived in London since 1959. So I've lived in England longer than I have in Scotland, which just still worries me a bit.
Farewell to Stromness, Peter Maxwell Davis. Richard Wilson, so you described your relationship with your parents, which sounds rather lovely, but you also mentioned that your father had quite a strict Presbyterian faith. I wonder how that shaped your childhood.
The rule was on a Sunday when my father was going to church, he used to say, "Are you coming to church today?" And I would say, "No, I'm not." And then he would stop talking to me until after he got back from church, and we had lunch. He just wouldn't talk to me. But I went past religion when I was quite young, I just stopped believing.
And did it bother you that you lost your faith?
No. No. It was a relief, a release.
You caught the acting bug quite young. That came to you, I think, when you were about 11, you made your debut in The Princess and the Pea.
That's right. Well researched.
So tell me about that part.
I put Anne Carey's knickers on as a pair of trousers.
Kind of pantaloons.
Pantaloons, that's the word. Thank you. I was a very skinny child and I could get quite a good laugh. And it was very beautiful to get such a response.
And what were you like as a child yourself? Because as you say, you were quite skinny, I think self-conscious. Were you shy?
I was shy. And there's another terrible admission. As I grew older, and then I started having a drink or two, I look upon alcohol as something that really helped me become somebody else and be somebody who had a bit more to say. I could make arguments when I had a few pints in me, which I wouldn't have dared say when I was totally sober.
So you used it to lower your inhibitions.
I brought in a flask right now, which you haven't seen.
I thought I'd searched you thoroughly. How dare you? I thought we were friends. And as you got a little bit older, you also started performing with amateur theatre groups. What kind of parts were you playing?
I remember getting my first sort of comedy, and I was in the coal house getting coal in for the fire, and the Greenock Telegraph arrived, and I opened it in the bunker to read the review, and it was quite promising. I say with modesty.
It was a rave.
No, I wouldn't go that far.
But you were in the coal house. That's showbiz in a nutshell, isn't it?
Yeah.
Let's have some more music. Your third disc today. What's it going to be and why?
The last four songs of Strauss. I hadn't listened to the last four songs for a long time, and I played it again. And it was just, I just loved it as much as ever.
Bent wrote from Four Last Songs by Richard Strauss, performed by René Fleming with the Houston Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Christoph Eschenbach. Richard Wilson, by the time you reached your teens, you'd secretly started to harbour the dream of being an actor. How did that go down with Mabel Irving, your drama teacher at the time?
I remember her asking me, she said, Wilson, what are you going to do with yourself? And I got into a terrible flummox, and I said, please, miss, I think I want to be an actor. And she said, don't be stupid, boy, you can't speak properly. So, which was not a great thing for a teacher to say to a pupil.
No.
When I became well known, the BBC interviewed Mabel in the Greenock High School, my primary school. And she claimed that she hadn't said that.
So after leaving school, you started work at a hospital in Glasgow. You were a lab technician there. What kind of work were you doing and how did it suit you?
Well, I quite enjoyed it. I used to be in haematology at first, and I used to wear a white coat, as they don't do nowadays, and everyone called me doctor. because I was taking blood from them. And I used to tell them, look, I'm not a doctor. I'm a lab tech. And then when I said that, they got a bit frightened of this person with a big syringe who wasn't a doctor. So I stopped mentioning it.
So just leaned into the acting at that point.
Yes. So I enjoyed it from meeting the patients, I suppose.
I think observing patients helped you develop some of your acting techniques, didn't it?
Yeah. Yeah. It's the same with when I was in London, even when I could afford it, I never wanted to buy a car because I thought I won't see people anymore and I've got to keep an eye on them. And you could do that in the underground.
So you didn't learn to drive till you were 40, as
That's
I understand.
Right.
Just so that you could keep taking the tube and keep people watching.
Yeah.
All right, Richard, it's time to take a moment for some more music. This is your fourth disc today. Why have you chosen it?
I remember Alan Rickman rang me up one day and said, there's this dance company coming to Sadler's Wells called the Dance Theatre of Wuppertal, run by Pina Bausch. He said, do you fancy seeing it? And I said, yeah, I'll come along to that. And within seconds, I knew I was watching a genius. And so the music I'm going to choose just now is not of that first show that I saw, but is of another performance they did of The Rite of Spring by Stravinsky.
Part of Stravinsky's The Rite of Spring, performed by the City of Birmingham Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Sir Simon Rattle, taking you back to that Pina Bausch performance with your friend Alan Rickman. Richard, let me take you back to those years working in the lab in Glasgow.
Yeah.
At the time, I know that a discovery that you made that changed your life again, it was the Cosmo Cinema, and it opened up a new world for you.
Oh, yes.
What were you watching?
Yes. The Cosmo was a brilliant little cinema in Glasgow that showed a different foreign film every week. So I got into Swiss cinema, French cinema, Italian cinema, and I remember they showed the French comedy star Michel Hulot's Holidays, and I just thought it was so funny. It was wonderful.
In 1956, you were called up for national service and you joined the Royal Army Medical Corps. You were posted to Singapore. What type of diseases were you dealing with there? And was the work itself much different to what you've been doing in Glasgow?
Oh, well, yes. A lot of the people I was dealing with in Singapore were wounded soldiers because there was a war on in Malaysia.
Later in your career, you would go on to direct a play for television called Changing Step, written by your friend Anthony Scher.
That's right.
Set in 1917, and it tells the story of a group of wounded soldiers back from the front who are sent to a stately home to convalesce, as people sometimes were at the time. Many of the young men you cast were disabled themselves and amputees.
Yes.
and so on.
Yes, I made it clear that there would be no wounded soldiers, obviously badly wounded soldiers, who would be pretending. They had to be real.
Why was that important?
Well, because I'd seen so many war films where I didn't believe it. That's the old catchphrase. I always try not to say that.
Slipped out, that one.
I was slipped out. And I wanted the real stuff.
It's time for your fifth disc today. Tell us about this choice.
Ah, yes. This is from Almodovar's film, Talk to Her, I would just like this one to be in because it reminded me of my great desire for cinema when I got to London.
Dicen que por las noches no más se le iba en puro llorar. Dicen que no comía, no más se le iba en puro tomar. Juran que el mismo cielo se estremecía al oír su llanto. Cómo sufría por ella, que hasta en su muerte la fue llamando.
Caetano Veloso and Cuckoo Cuckoo Paloma from the soundtrack to the film Talk to Her. Richard Wilson, you decided to move to London. You arrived in the early 60s. Why?
Well, I suppose to see cinema, really, and to see theatre. And I had this thought in my mind that I just might become an actor.
You kept up the day job, worked at Paddington General Hospital, taking acting classes in your spare time. And at 27, you decided to audition for RADA. What made you decide to go for it?
Well, I remember talking to a RADA student at a party, and she told me, she said, you know, you could get into RADA and get your fees paid because you've lived in London for over a year now. And I had no idea about that. And so I thought, if I don't try now, I'm probably never going to try at 27. I thought I was getting a bit old.
And you got in. You made it to RADA. Of course, you had a broad Scottish accent in those days. And this is a long time ago when attitudes were quite different. This is the days of received pronunciation. Did your accent cause any problems for you?
Oh, gosh, yes. Before I went to RADA, it was even worse. When I spoke in London, I had to speak everything twice because people would say, what are you saying? My RADA English accent was so bad that they had to give me private lessons with a head voice teacher. So that's why I was very good at mime. That's what made me a director, in a way, because they don't do it anymore. But in the final term, the students were allowed to write and direct a mime play. So I was picked as director because my English was so poor. And I always then had this idea that I would act and direct. I never wanted to change that.
So, Richard, you graduated in 1965 and changed your name at that point from Ian to Richard Wilson because Equity already had an Ian Wilson listed on their books.
This Ian Wilson was a very small man who'd done a lot of films, but most of the parts he played, I think he had played about 20 night watchmen. and he was
typecast.
He was retiring. And I said to Equity, I said, look, if he's retiring, I'll keep my name. And they said, no, you've got to wait for 7 years.
Couldn't he have done the night shift? You could have done the day shift. So, Richard, you got your first job on the television series Dr. Finlay's Casebook. What was the part?
I was playing Mr. McKeely, the stonemason. This was with Andrew Cruikshank. The thing I do remember was going into the studio and I saw this machine, this television, and it was me staring into it. I realised, of course, then that everything wasn't in black and white. There was no colour television at the time.
So the studio monitors were in colour?
Yeah.
What was that like, seeing yourself on screen?
It was absolutely frightening. I never wanted to do it again.
It's time for disc number 6, Richard. What are we going to hear?
When I first came down to London, I used to go to folk clubs with Ewan McCall and Peggy Seeger, and he had written this song for her. And then when I was planning to do Desert Island Discs...
Roberta Flack. So, Richard, television viewers first got to know you more in 1973 when you starred as the sarcastic, sneery QC Jeremy Parsons in the very popular series Crown Court.
Oh,
so
yes.
The format was a fictional court case with actors playing the legal counsel and the general public as the jury. Now, many of your fellow actors apparently didn't feel the need to learn their lines because they could read from the written briefs from their props that they had with them. But you were very diligent and ended up working in your favour. What happened?
I wanted to look at the witnesses and make them suffer from my questioning. so I tried to learn as much as I could. And I wanted to be a defence counsel. And I succeeded in defending most of the cases because I didn't like the idea of proving people guilty.
From then on, Richard, alongside your theatre work, you appeared in sitcoms and drama series, including Tutti Frutti, alongside Robbie, Coltrane and Emma Thompson.
Yes.
Just a wonderful part. And then in 1990, you were sent some scripts written by David Renwick about a grumpy pensioner who had just retired.
Yes.
But you initially turned down the part of Victor Meldrew.
I did. It was stupid to say, but I didn't think I was ready to play old men. I think I was 55. Victor was 60. And I thought, I've got another 5 years to go before I have to do that. The other reason I wasn't too keen to play it was I thought it would only be enjoyed by old people. But in fact, old people didn't like it.
Because, there were a few complaints, weren't there?
Yes, because, first of all, he swore a lot. The BBC wanted to stop him swearing. And fortunately, David Renwick decided to keep him swearing. But also, the idea that a lot of old people had was one foot in the grave meant that they were going to die. But, of course, the whole point about Victor was it was the foot that was out of the grave that was the important one that was still working away. But then Susie Belbin, the producer, sent me some more scripts because she was determined to try and get me. So as soon as I went in, I knew I was going to say yes.
One Foot in the Grave was a smash hit, regularly attracted audiences of 17 million, and it's still regarded as one of the greatest British sitcoms of all time. You won two BAFTAs for your performance, but it did come to an end after 36 episodes. What happened?
I remember I was doing my second Waiting for Godot in Manchester when David came to see it, and over dinner he said, I'm thinking of killing Victor. What do you think? And I said, yeah, I think we should kill him. I thought I had enough of him.
What was it like filming that last episode? Was it emotional?
No. No, I think I was quite pleased that we were going to a changing area.
You were ready to move on.
I was ready to move on.
But it's pretty amazing that, you know, all these years later, just those six series have continued to have a life of their own and to be a part of popular culture.
Yes, that's true. And I still get shouted at, the catchphrase.
Did the people who were doing it always think they're the first person to do it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I used to say, good heavens, do you know, I've never heard that before. And they say, really?
It's time for your seventh disc today, Richard. What are we going to hear?
Once I knew I was doing this, of course, everyone was asking me, what are you going to have? And then a writer friend, Ewan Armstrong, said to me, have you got the Roaches in? I remember enjoying the Roaches hugely when they were popular many years ago. And I said, no, I haven't got, but I'll put them in.
If you go down.
Hammond's song, The Roaches. Richard Wilson, you do live alone at the moment, but I think at one point you thought about buying a big house in the country with your friend Ian McKellen.
Please tell me that's still on the cards.
Yes, we had this idea of buying a very, very large house in the country, and he would live on one side and I would live on the other
side. A wing each? What could be better?
A wing each. But he's got more houses in London now, so he got fed up with that idea.
Can't pretend I'm not disappointed, Richard. So much like Ian McKellen, you are a longtime supporter of Stonewall. You actually hosted their awards show in 2008.
I did.
But you yourself weren't officially out until 2013, and that was when a magazine included you in a list of influential gay people. What was your reaction when it happened?
I was delighted that it had come out, and I was a bit worried that my sister might find it difficult, but she didn't seem to worry at all.
And what about when you were growing up? I mean, the 50s wasn't the easiest time to be gay. Did your sexuality cause problems for you back then as a young man?
Yes. I suppose that's true. I did always have a lot of very close friends, which were very important to me, gay and straight. That was very important to me.
Of course, I'm about to send you off to the island.
Oh, yes.
What's your strategy for survival going to be, Richard?
I don't know how good I'll be on it in terms of... I'm hopeless at building things. Mm. But I have lived alone for a very long time, and I quite like being alone at times.
You like your own company?
Yeah. I quite like it at times. It's just every now and again I feel I should have made a bit more effort to have a partner. But that never really worked.
That never happened for you?
No.
Richard, we're going to hear one more disc before we send you off to the island. Your final choice today. What's it going to be?
This is one of my favourite classical pieces. And I'm also a great fan of Young Musician of the Year competition on the telly. I just get so impressed by them. And so jealous of them. There was a cellist called Shekhukani Mason. I knew that when I saw Young Musician of the Year that year that he had to win it. I thought he was by far the best.
Part of the first movement of Elgar's Cello Concerto in E minor, played by Shekhukani Mason with the London Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Sir Simon Rattle. So, Richard Wilson, it's time. I'm sending you away to the island. You can have the Bible and the complete works of Shakespeare, and you can choose another book as well. What would you like?
Well, I'm not interested in the Bible or the Shakespeare too much, but I wouldn't want to go away without the poems of Robert Burns.
Any particular favourites? There might be sleek at Curran, timorous beasties on the island. You never know.
Poor wee sleek at Curran, timorous beastie. Oh, what a panic's in thy beastie. That's one of my favourites.
You can also have a luxury item. What would you like?
Is there any chance that I might get copies of The Guardian?
Mm.
Is that allowed?
Well, Richard, I happen to know that there is precedent for this. Castaways have taken newspaper subscriptions in the past.
Yes.
So I can furnish you with one for your preferred choice, The Guardian. And finally, which one track of the eight that you've shared with us today would you save from the waves?
Well, I think I'm going to